My name is Joe Allen. Sitting beside me is Anna Fisher. We were crewmates together on the Space Shuttle Mission 51A, the mission that carried out the first space salvage of two satellites that were lost. We're going to tell you about the mission and share with you some of the photographs taken, movies taken, and so on. But before we do that, I think it's useful to look back over the course of the past year. Many things have happened in the world of space flight, starting nearly a year ago with Space Shuttle Mission number 10 that took the satellites to orbit that were ultimately lost.
3 februari 1984. Shuttlevlucht 41B.
En daar gaat vlucht 41B, met aan boord twee kunstmanen die in een baan om de aarde gebracht moeten worden. Hier zien we de lancering van de Westar-kunstmaan.
Hey Houston, Challenger.
Challenger, Houston.
En intussen bereidt de bemanning de lancering van de tweede kunstmaan voor, de Palapa. Geen van beide lanceringen is een succes. De startmotoren blijken niet goed te werken. De kunstmanen kunnen niet in de juiste baan worden gebracht en gaan verloren. Een ander onderdeel van de vlucht slaagt wel. Astronaut Bruce McCandless gaat een ruimtewandeling maken, waarbij hij zich op eigen kracht door middel van een speciale ruimtestoel met ingebouwd voortstuwingsmechanisme vrij in de ruimte kan verplaatsen. De richting wordt bepaald door middel van handbediening. Hier zien we de eerste menselijke kunstmaan ver boven het aardoppervlak. De kromming van de aarde is duidelijk zichtbaar. Voor terugkeer naar aarde worden de twee laadruimdeuren van de shuttle weer gesloten. De landingsbaan op Kaap Kennedy. Uitzicht vanuit het rechter cockpitraam. En de shuttle duikt als een zweefvliegtuig in vrije val op zijn doel af. De landing van een space shuttle op Kaap Kennedy is geslaagd.
Zes april 1984. Shuttlevlucht 41C.
Lancering van vlucht 41C. Belangrijkste taak, het repareren van een defect geraakte kunstmaan in de ruimte voor het eerst in de geschiedenis. Hier is die kunstmaan, de Solar Max.
Roger, that sounds real good to us.
Astronaut Keith Nelson verlaat de Space Shuttle op weg naar de defecte satelliet. Doel, het verhelpen van een reeks problemen met de stabilisatie. Hier zien we onder in beeld de astronaut bij de kunstbaan aankomen. Geen gemakkelijke klus, omdat de satelliet heel langzaam om zijn eigen as draait. Keith Nelson brengt de kunstbaan naar de laadruimte van de shuttle. De defecte satelliet is duidelijk zichtbaar. Het is die opgerichte zwarte cilinder midden in beeld. Rechts in beeld is een stuk van de mechanische arm te zien waarmee de kunstmaan aan boord is getild. Na een uur of vijf is de hele klus geklaard. De vluchtleiding in Houston controleert of alle systemen naar behoren functioneren en geeft de bemanning opdracht de kunstmaan weer overboord te zetten. Na gedane arbeid is het goed eten, maar gewichteloosheid blijft komisch. De cockpit tijdens de afdaling in de dampkring. Een kijkje over de schouder van commandant Crippen. Door de ramen de rode gloed van het hitteschild. Terugkeer op de luchtmachtbasis Edwards in Californië. Na een vlucht van 6 dagen en na meer dan 4 miljoen kilometer te hebben afgelegd.
Roger, welcome back on Friday the 41, Charlie.
Unofficial touchdown time 7:38:05.
29 augustus 1984. Shuttlevlucht 41D.
Jammer, geen start. 4 seconden voor het vertrek. Brand in motor nummer 3. De computers blokkeren de start. Teleurgesteld verlaten de ruimtevaarders de shuttle. De brand richt grote schade aan en de ruimtependel moet terug naar het assemblagegebouw. Na 2 maanden van intensieve reparatie is de shuttle weer klaar voor vertrek naar de lanceerplaats en het aftellen kan opnieuw beginnen.
We have a go for main engine start. 6. We have main engine start. 3, 2, 1. We have SRB ignition and we have liftoff. Liftoff of mission 41B.
De 12e shuttlevlucht, 41D, op weg naar zijn baan om de aarde. Let op de koersaanpassing. Een korte flits als de correctiemotor aangaat. Meteen na vertrek drukken werkzaamheden aan boord. Charles Walker, de eerste betalende passagier, bezig met een commercieel farmaceutisch experiment waarbij chemische stoffen in gewichteloze toestand van elkaar worden gescheiden. Dat gaat sneller dan op aarde. Doel, het maken van nog betere geneesmiddelen. Niet alleen farmaceutische proeven tijdens deze vlucht. Ook worden er 3 kunstmanen gelanceerd. Nummer 1, de SBS, een commerciële kunstmaan. Een dag later, nummer 2, de LISAT, een communicatiesatelliet die in een draaiende beweging wordt gelanceerd om de stabilisatie te vergroten.
This is Mission Control Houston. We have a nominal spin up to 50 RPM on time.
Langzamerhand wordt de draaiing opgevoerd tot 30 omwentelingen per minuut. En weer een dag later, de volgende, de Telstar 3. Waar slapen 6 mensen in zo'n kleine ruimte? In gewichteloosheid, waar geen verschil is tussen boven- en onderkant, kan dat staande en liggend. De laatste proef van deze vlucht. Het ontvouwen van een gigantisch zonnepaneel. Judy Resnick, de tweede Amerikaanse vrouw in de ruimte, bedient de knoppen. Het paneel waarmee zonne-energie kan worden omgezet in elektriciteit is 10 meter breed en 30 meter lang.
En we geven je de elbow aan de the downlink while we're taking 10 minutes worth of data.
Voor de terugkeer naar aarde, nog even een gezamenlijke maaltijd.
Touchdown at mission lapse time of.
Na 97 keer om de aarde te hebben gecirkeld, landt de shuttle.
5 oktober 1984. Shuttlevlucht 41G. Vertrek van de eerste Space Shuttle-vlucht met 7 astronauten aan boord, waarvan voor het eerst 2 vrouwen. Iets meer dan 2 minuten na het vertrek worden de startraketten afgestoten en vallen ze terug in zee. Zo'n 6 minuten later bevindt de shuttle zich in zijn baan om de aarde.
Down.
Sally Ride bedient de mechanische arm waarmee de kunstmaan ERPS overboord wordt gezet. Blik vanaf de achterkant van de shuttle. De aarde, met op zo'n kleine 200 kilometer beneden ons, de Nijldelta. Snelheid 27.000 kilometer per uur. De Sinaï-woestijn, de Rode Zee, de Golf van Suez.
Challenger Houston.
Go ahead.
Alweer een experiment. Astronaut Scully Power, rechts in beeld, onderzoekt of zijn verblijf in de ruimte tot fysieke aanpassingsproblemen heeft geleid. Geen worstjes, maar wortelen. Voor Mark Carno, een lekkernij. Voor de terugkeer nog even een beetje ontspanning. Vlucht van 8 dagen en een afstand van 7,5 miljoen kilometer landt de Challenger op Kaap Kennedy.
8 november 1984. Shuttlevlucht 51A.
Training voor de vlucht. Commandant Hawk, links in beeld, en Anna Fisher in de vluchtnabootser van de Space Shuttle. Terwijl Anna nog eens nauwkeurig de gegevens van het vluchtplan doorneemt, wordt in een andere ruimte collega Joe Allen voorbereid op een onderwatertest. Een technicus helpt Allen een handje vlak voordat hij afdaalt in een groot zwembad, waarin zich een model van de Space Shuttle bevindt. Ruim van het ruimtevaartuig is exact nagemaakt, zodat onder water zo getrouw mogelijk kan worden geëxperimenteerd met de gewichteloze toestand. Terug naar Anna in de vluchtnabootser. Ze wordt getraind in het besturen van de mechanische arm die, eenmaal in de ruimte, satellieten aan boord moet halen. Een lastige klus die zeer nauwkeurig werk vereist. Met de mechanische arm worden de kunstmanen opgepikt en aan boord van de shuttle gehesen om in de laadruimte te worden gerepareerd. Hier een model van zo'n kunstmaan. Weer naar Joe voor een ander experiment met de zogeheten koppelstaaf. Joe bootst de koppeling met een kunstmaan na. Op borsthoogte zit een grote staaf gemonteerd, waarmee de satelliet rechts in beeld als het ware oppikt. De lange pen schuift langzaam in de kunstmaan en blijft zitten. Koppeling in de ruimte. En nu weer het woord aan Joe Allen en Anna Fisher.
Now we'd like to share with you experiences that we had on the space mission that has recently ended, during which time we took two satellites to orbit and we covered the two lost satellites from orbit. We'd like to begin by sharing with you a movie made up both of movie film and television film that we took during the course of the mission.
7, 6, 5, we have main engine start. 3, 2, 1, and liftoff of Discovery, and the first flight to retrieve the return satellites from space, and the shuttle has cleared the tower.
Tower clear.
Roger, roll. Probe program initiated, Houston now controlling. Probe program completed. Throttle down to 89%, then to 67%. Tube pass through the period of maximum aerodynamic pressure. Throttle down to 67, confirmed. 45 seconds. Downrange distance 2 nautical miles. Altitude 3.9 nautical miles. Velocity 2,200 feet.
You can see it's a cloudy day as seen from the ground.
Beginning throttle up.
But from our point of view, we were up above the clouds within the first 15 seconds or 20 seconds. And 8 minutes later, we look out the window and this is the view that we see from orbit about the Earth, the Atlantic Ocean below us.
And it's indeed a very special view and a very privileged one that those of us have a chance to see. We'll introduce the crew here. This is our commander, Rick Houck, floating out of the commander's seat to the aft flight deck. Our pilot, Dave Walker. Mission Specialist 1, Joe Allen. Mission Specialist 2, myself, Anna Fisher. See us floating around having a good time here. And MS3, or Mission Specialist 3, Dale Gardner.
Okay, Ron, if you've got a good TV, we're going to start the VTR dump now.
Roger, Joe, we have good TV and we finally have some good voice, so we're ready.
Okay, stand by.
The purpose of the mission really was to carry two satellites to orbit. This was the first satellite, a communication satellite, that we launched actually during the night time. So we were on the dark side of the Earth, which is why this television footage is not particularly clear.
Okay. It was very spectacular to see that huge satellite as it moved away.
Now we'll take you on a tour of the spaceship. Dave is leaving the flight deck, the upper deck, and going below to the mid-deck, the second portion of the living volume of the spaceship, and he's going down head first. Of course, just floating, as all of us would float during the course of the time in the orbit. We're looking right down at the floor of the mid-deck.
And on the right, you see the handle of our treadmill where we exercise. You see our lockers ahead where all of our equipment is stowed. You see foot restraints, which are the means by which we stabilized ourselves when we wanted to get into those lockers. And on the wall, you see our sleep restraints, which some of us chose to use that. Other people just chose to float freely.
This is mealtime aboard the spaceship. Anna and Rick are preparing a meal. Rick, right at that moment, is talking to the ground. He's received a call from the ground, and he answers back using a rather normal-looking microphone. Butter cookies, he says. It's good for you. These are sugar-coated candy.
And as you can see, we are definitely in zero-G because the candies are floating away. And as you'll see shortly, after a meal or after a task, our commander chose to reward us by letting us, if we did a good job, float and eat some of them.
He was giving us a reward for proper performance during the course of the day. I think, Anna, you're getting more than your share. You can see that life aboard a spaceship is very amusing in many ways because everything floats.
Oh, yes. Everything floats in zero gravity, including your hair. And although I thought my hair was fairly short, in zero G, it becomes a lot fuller. And since I had longer hair than any of my fellow crew members, it was more obvious, I think.
I have here a series of pictures. And you see on the first one, a drink container. And like with all drink containers, the way we get fluid out of the container is either to suck it out with a straw, or we can just push on the container and the drink comes out like a glob, like very, very weak jello, or in fact, the liquid that it is. And you see here in this photograph, the chocolate drink as it's coming out in two blobs. In the next picture, the drink has come loose from the container and in fact is just floating as a sphere, a perfectly round object, a globule. I'm attempted to call it a bubble, but it's not a bubble because it does not have air in it. It's solid liquid through and through. A person floating in space with a glob of liquid can put a straw right into the center and drink it. So it's completely gone. You can also, if you're both brave and perhaps foolish, move your mouth up to it and try just to drink it like that. But if you're not careful, it will attach to the outside of your face and run, for example, down onto your chin, as you see in this last picture.
If I could add one thing here, one of the interesting aspects of spaceflight is that you get to know your other crew members fairly well. It's almost like a family because you've been training together for on the order of a year. And one of the things we learned about Joe is that he was a master, if you will, on globs. And every time we turned around, there was a glob of something, either chocolate drink, water, or orange juice. And as a result, I suspect that in all my future flights, having trained under Dr. Yes. Allen, I will be showing that to future astronauts. Yes.
Everyone must be an expert in something, and I'm an expert in globs. It's not much, but it's all I have.
This is a view of my little girl, Kristen Ann, who was 15 months at the time that we launched. And I'm told by my friends and my husband that she would spend a great deal of time in the viewing room in Mission Control. I think this might have been during one of our EVAs. And this, during this time frame, she'd have her nose pressed up against the window there. And my husband told me that one by one, each of the flight controllers turned around and she stood there and was waving at everyone.
Who was watching us in
That's
orbit?
Right.
They were all watching Kristen.
In this particular sequence, you see Dale Gardner coming down to the flight deck because I guess Joe Allen has been described as small in stature but rather large in personality. And when he got a little bit too big, we stuffed him away, and it was Dale's job to go and try to extract him from the locker where we have put him to keep him quiet for a while. And here you see Dale trying to pull him out of the locker, and I guess Joe was probably fairly relieved at this
point.
And
I can't believe you included this in the movie to be shown on television.
Well, I thought that our audience ought to know what we really thought of you there, Joe.
Well, I'm not sure I'm amused. Actually, this is funny. I dust myself off, and we get about our business. We said at the beginning that the purpose of the flight was to take two satellites to orbit. We also were assigned the rather interesting task of picking up two satellites that were lost in space. And while Dale and I on the middeck got ready to go outside the spaceship in spacesuits, Rick Hauck and Anna prepared to catch the satellites, that is to bring the space shuttle up very close to the satellite at a time. This is a process known as a rendezvous, and it involves a large number of rocket burns, many, many calculations using a computer, and then sighting through a special optical sight to see the satellite.
In this particular view, we're seeing the satellite at a distance of about 50 miles, and it looked like the brightest star you could imagine. And I can't tell you how happy we were to see it come up in that sight. This is a view when the satellite's at about 100 feet and now coming in closer. We were bringing it down to where it was just in view of the remote manipulator arm, or the mechanical arm, which has a TV at the end of it. And that is the means by which our commander was able to null out the rates.
Anna's giving a report to the ground saying that we have grabbed the satellite the first time. And I fly back to the Discovery, put the backpack away, and then I will hold the satellite while Dale puts on the last piece of large tooling that's necessary to stow it finally aboard. You can see in this sequence that it is very easy to fly the backpack. It's a bit like ice skating, but on three-dimensional ice. Everything moves very smoothly, very slick, and totally silent. And you just fly the backpack wherever you want, right up to the spaceship if you want. And in fact, you can see reflected in my helmet one of the bulkheads of the space shuttle. And you see the reflection of the arm and even the light shining out from the space shuttle that they're using to illuminate my helmet, and the reflection of the sun also in the top of the helmet.
If you look real closely, you could probably see three noses pressed up against the window of the commander pilot and the arm operator, because for 6 hours we were really glued to those windows, watching all the tethers and trying to keep track of everything that Joe and Dale were doing. And in this sequence, we see the EVA crew and Dale heading out to join up with the satellite.
And in this view, indeed, you can see the means we used to catch the satellite the first time. A crewman in a spacesuit with the backpack and a maneuvering device literally flies over to the satellite and stabs it with a probe affixed to the front of the suit. And you'll see this unfold. Dale is flying the backpack unit, and you can see attached to the front of his body a large device that is used to insert into the rocket engine of the satellite. Now the satellite is spinning. Dale is flying over and is not spinning, but the minute he touches the satellite, he will begin to spin with it. You can see the Earth below and the arm off to the right of the picture, which Anna is controlling and helping to guide the spaceship to keep it very near the satellite.
Going for toggle. Hey, toggle, they got it.
Cycle, gyro time.
Hey, cycle, flag gave it a good knock. Hey, cycle on gyro power. It's off and back on. Start to torque. Go speed disk. Go.
Yeah.
It's just like you said.
You see below Mexico and Central America. Now the crewman that affixes himself to the satellite can then stop both himself and the satellite using the backpack, and then literally tug the satellite over near the arm, and Anna, in a very difficult maneuver, reaches out with the arm and can grasp the satellite and the person affixed to it. And in fact, I would say a little closer, a little farther up, a little to the right, and she would follow directions and move me exactly as I wanted to go. And then I grabbed the satellite. The procedure then was for me to hold the satellite for the many, many minutes. In fact, it was nearly an hour and a half that it took Dale to let go of it, come back, get another large piece of equipment, and fasten it to this far end of the satellite. The sun would come up and would shine on the back of my hands, and I could feel my hands getting warmer and warmer. Not to the point of being very uncomfortable, but certainly warmer. And then I realized that I could let go with one hand and put one of my hands in the shade of my other arm, or I can even move a hand under a covering on the satellite. A thin film covering, and the minute I would put a hand in the shade, my hand would begin to feel cool again. And so I did that very deliberately during the daylight portions of the mission, and daylight lasts only for 45 minutes, and then nighttime comes for 45 minutes.
You might want to comment, Joe, on what it felt like to be on the end of the arm, because you've had some interesting comments about that.
You can see in this picture that the person that is on the end of the arm stands on a very small platform, and your feet are held by a very small platform. And you can also move to one side the workstation that you use to get onto the platform. And once you do that, you are quite literally standing on a very high diving board. And you know that the diving board is being operated by a skilled operator, but still you're hoping that you don't fall off the diving board, because you look down and you see the shuttle many feet below you, maybe 50 feet below you. It looks like it's a long way away, and then 200 miles beyond that is the Earth, moving by with a speed of 17,000 miles an hour. And so the one's perception of where you are can be a little bit frightening on the diving board, but I was not nervous, not too nervous.
I know.
We even had time at the end to take this photograph that says for sale. We have two satellites, each worth about $30 million apiece, nearly brand new, practically unused, and we're going to bring them home and sell them and then reuse them. I think Atlantic Ocean passing underneath, and the satellites stowed safely aboard. We have additional photographs that we took from the spaceship. We have, in fact, nearly 2,000 of these. We won't show all 2,000 today, but we have an assortment of just a few, and they represent really what human eye sees from the space shuttle as you look down.
This is a view of Magdalena Bay in Baja, California. It is one of the three sanctuaries and mating areas of the gray whale, and it's a very spectacular photo. You can see the way the tide is pooling into that bay, which provides the proper nutrients for the whales.
And another example of that, we've mentioned earlier that when one orbits the Earth, you go from daylight into darkness, back into daylight again, and this happens every 45 minutes. And so during the normal Earth day, normal 24-hour period, we in orbit about the Earth, experience 16 sunrises and sunsets, a sunrise and a sunset every hour and a half. And in this particular picture, we're going from the daylight into the darkness, so the sun is setting, and it's casting very long shadows across the tops of clouds, thunderstorm clouds that are coming up into the atmosphere. And one's impression is of flying right along the shadows from the daylight, right along the shadows of the clouds into the darkness, all of which happens in about 20 seconds time, and it's very beautiful and striking experience.
30 seconds to sunrise. Okay.
The eighth day of the space mission, a re-entry that started really over the Indian Ocean, but we made a deorbit burn, and then we fly in the spaceship lower and lower, and finally touching the atmosphere of the Earth and slowing down in the atmosphere, slowing our speed from about Mach 27 or 27 times the speed of sound, down to a more normal flying speed for a normal airplane. And this particular photograph was taken as we were traveling about Mach 16 as we came right over Houston, Texas. And it was taken by our friends and neighbors, some of our friends and neighbors here around the Johnson Space Center in Houston. And we were headed towards Florida to land in Florida. And we arrived in Florida just a few minutes after this this very spectacular shot of us streaking over the city was taken.
Mission Control, Houston, we have reports that Discovery was sighted as it crossed the Houston area. We're now processing data through the MILA tracking station located at Kennedy Space Center. Velocity 600 feet per second, now at 11,000 feet. 6 nautical miles to go.
Discovery, Houston, on glide slope, on centerline.
Now 1,100 feet. 1.4 nautical miles.
Here you see the orbiter as it's coming into the runway. The gear is put down at about 300 feet. Rick and Dave are at command of the orbiter. After main gear touchdown, we bring the nose down, And then Rick commenced some light braking at just under 100 miles per hour.
Discovery now rolling out, runway 15, Kennedy Space Center. After a 2.5 million mile service call, the crew of 51A is home. Just had a report that our entry time was 4 seconds off.
Roger, wheel stop. Look like an okay pass all the way.
Okay, we'll get into the post landing.
Mission Control, Houston, we now have exit of the 51A crew led by Commander Rick Houck, followed by Pilot Dave Walker, Mission Specialist Joe Allen, Anna Fisher, and bringing up the rear, Dale Gardner.
When you finally land at the Cape, you go through a period where you get a post-flight physical, and then shortly after that, they put you on an airplane and fly you back to Ellington Air Force Base, which is right near the Johnson Space Center in Houston. And waiting there for me was my husband, my mom, and my grandmother with my little girl, Kristen, and that was a very special moment for all of us.